by the roll call by the clerk.
Nancy Masterton?
Here.
Jane Amorow?
Here.
Penelope Carson?
Here.
Lester Jordan?
Here.
William Jordan?
Here.
Frank Littori?
Here.
Douglas Tinsman?
Here.
Madam Chairman, all seven counselors are present.
Thank you. The first order of business tonight is to bid farewell to three of our counselors who are retiring from public service, at least service on the town council. They are Penelope Carson, Counselor Lester Jordan, and Counselor Douglas Tinsman. The remaining members of the council look back on the past with many warm memories, many laughs, many struggles. All three of these counselors have received the traditional silver bowl at our silver bowl party, which took place last night. And we had a wonderful time. We had a lot of laughs remembering back. So good luck to all of you, and thank you for your public service. The minutes of the meeting held on May 9th and the minutes of the meeting held on May 25th. Are there any corrections?
Madam Chairman, I move Councilor the minutes of both the meetings of May 9th and May 25th be accepted as written.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? It's unanimous. We have now come to the time when citizens may address any items of their choosing that are not on the agenda. This is through a new rule that we have recently passed. You will still have an opportunity to speak at the end of the meeting when all the council agenda is finished, but this is a new feature, and if anyone has anything on their mind, we invite you to make a presentation to us. Well, I see a lot of heads going no, so we will now move on to reports and correspondence. Any reports from council members? Well, I wish to report that we had a small but enthusiastic group at the Memorial Day exercise. The weather did not cooperate, and we moved inside to the middle school gym and spent 5 or 10 minutes looking for a light switch in the gym and couldn't find it, so it was a little dismal and gloomy in the gym. But we had an absolutely glorious exercise in which three students from the middle school took part. A fourth grader, a sixth grader, and an eighth grader won the essay contest that was put on by the school board, and they all read their essays, and it was very well received. We wish that a few more, a lot more, had turned out for the Memorial Day exercise. And if there are any grumbles from anyone who thinks that we should do something a little more elaborate, I wish that you would come forward and offer your services next year. We were not able to get up a parade because people are going off for the weekend and the kids don't want to march, and that's a shame. So if you have any ideas to improve our Memorial Day exercise, please step forward before next year. And the second event that has taken place is the formal dedication of the Southern Cape treatment plant. And that took place with representatives of the Portland Water District, the council, the contractors, the engineering firm, and tours were conducted, and we hear that everything is going very well. No problems as yet. Penny?
I might take this opportunity for the report section that, as you know, I'm still serving on the Jetport Noise Abatement Committee, which has been meeting regularly. It is indeed a very complicated issue. We do occasionally get complaints from people in Cape Elizabeth about planes that are coming over part of the town that they are not supposed to, that's not on their regular route. But to take any of these items into consideration to actually abate the noise means that you're taking into the size of the plane, the type of engines, the weight, the wind, the direction. There are so many things to take into consideration. The committee is made up of mostly people from the airline industry in some capacity, as well as people who represent their neighborhoods. I think it's, I think you have to take into consideration when you wonder what's going to be happening is that the people in the West End are saying of Portland, don't send the planes over to us. Scarborough or Stroudwater is saying, don't send the planes over us. South Portland is saying, don't send the planes over us. And I'm there trying to say, don't send the planes over Cape Elizabeth. So it becomes a very parochial point of view. There is going to be a new routing, and it goes, it hangs right before the bridge, goes out 77, and mostly goes over Scarborough. The problem is that it never made its height the first time, and it went over two lights. And never made the corner. That was the first time they tried the new route. I assume that I'm going to stay on that committee. It is complicated. It is very tedious. It is coming to a close, I think, in 6 months. I just thought I'd tell you it is ongoing.
Well, Penny, we would like to have some continuity. I served on it briefly, and Jane, did you?
I was on it for about a week.
A week is about enough.
And I will agree that it is a little tedious and technical.
Well, I think the other thing is that you have to take into consideration the business community. There are one or two representatives there who have asked for curfews on all the airlines. They do not want any airplanes to take off before 8 o'clock in the morning or to land after 8 o'clock at night. And in a burgeoning business community in a developing area of Greater Portland, that is indeed, seems to me, unrealistic to even hope that it will pass. But this is the kind of thing that comes before the committee as recommendations to abate noise. I will say, I didn't even know where those planes were going to fly, but I absolutely refused to put those kind of curfews on the airline. The crimp in the business community would be too severe, and I think there would be an uprising at any rate from somebody. I switched hats. I said, I'm no longer Cape Elizabeth, I'm business. So that's what's happening.
Jane.
I just have one brief announcement. The State Board of Education is going to be meeting in Portland for the first time in over a year and a half, and they will be here tomorrow, meeting in a workshop session at 2:30, and Wednesday morning, our regular meeting will be held at 9 o'clock at the Portland Regional Vocational Center. So if there's anybody interested in attending on two beautiful 90-degree days that are coming up, we'd love to see you.
Michael?
Again, two very, very brief announcements. First, I'd like to introduce an intern who is working with us this summer, a senior at the University of Maine in the public management program, Bridget Sullivan. Welcome. She's standing in the back, almost standing. Thank you. And the second announcement is, as the council knows, for the last 4 or 5 months, we've been negotiating with the Cape Elizabeth Police Patrolmen's Association. This past Friday, the association ratified an agreement as proposed by the town council at your last meeting, and that will be on the council agenda on July 11th for final action by the town council. Thank you.
Thank you, Mike. We will now go on to a public hearing on the Good Table Restaurant, a malt and Venus license renewal. We will open the public hearing. Is there anyone representing the restaurant. Yes, sir. Would you come up to the podium, please, and speak into the microphone? And identify yourself, please.
Yeah, my name is Tony Costopoulos, and my daughter owns the Good Table Restaurant. And we're just trying to get a renewal on a beer and wine license. We've had no problems in the past year, so, I mean, it's up to you people, I guess.
Thank you. Is there anyone from the public who wishes to speak on this license? If not, then we will close the public hearing, and we will consider number item 102. 101. To consider approving a renewal application for a full-time malt and Venus license for Lisa Costopoulos, the Good Table Restaurant, and take any necessary action.
I move approval.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? It's unanimous. We have another public hearing on boat repair facilities. This is an amendment to section 19-2-2 of the Cape Elizabeth Zoning Ordinance by adding paragraph P, boat repair facility, in which boats are built or repaired, provided that no more than four persons shall be engaged on a continuous basis in boat construction or repair, that no such facility shall be maintained for commercial purposes on any lot containing less than 200,000 square feet, that 150 feet front, side, and rear setbacks from any public roads or from any abutting properties be provided on the lot with the facility, that the visibility of the facility be minimized from abutting properties and from any public roads, that the facility not have a commercial appearance, that no outside storage of boats or materials that is visible from any public road shall be permitted, that the hours of operation shall be limited to between the hours of 8 a.m. and 6 p.m., that no boat shall be built or repaired at such facility to be transported over public roads which will endanger the safety of the public or require the moving of utility lines, and that site plan review and approval by the planning board shall be required. Douglas, did you have?
Sure. Councilor Carson and I met as the revised ordinance committee and discussed this at great length. Basically, this amendment has been before the Zoning Board of Appeals, the Planning Board, back to the Council, referred to the Ordinance Committee, and has been refined down to the language that appears before us. The basic difference between how it came out of those other two boards, primarily the Planning Board, is that we felt it unnecessary to require 20 acres for a facility like this. It seemed that there were about 20 such chunks of land in town that would allow this sort of facility to happen, and we felt that it was a little too restrictive. We reduced it to 5 acres with the 150-foot setbacks front, rear, and side, properly sheltered from abutters in the road. And that increased the likelihood up to 96 potential sites in town. I don't think we'll see a great run on boat building facilities in town, but it seemed more reasonable. The other addition is that it not causing the infringement of transportation rights of others. And basically, that's the last few lines in the ordinance that we recommend adopted tonight. So that's how it's been refined down through the process. It's been a timely process, and it, we hope that it's refined down to what can be very workable.
Thanks, Doug. Councillor Lester Jordan.
I feel I should abstain from this item 102 because of a possible conflict.
Councillor William Jordan.
I feel I should abstain from
acting on item 102 due to discussing it with the town attorney that possibly a conflict.
Is it the consensus of the remainder of the council to allow these two gentlemen to abstain?
Yes.
All right. Then we will now open the public hearing on boat repair facilities. Is there anyone from the public who wishes to speak on this item?
Madam Chairperson, my name is Peter Murray, and I'm appearing in the capacity as attorney for Mr. Sprague, who is the proprietor of the boat repair facility which inspired this proposed revision. And I won't take the time to extensively sketch out the background of this because, as Councilman Tinsman pointed out, it's already been before you a couple of times, been before several boards of Cape Elizabeth, and I think you probably know both the reason why we're here as well as quite a lot about the facility itself. There's one point, though, that I thought might address because it's been raised in discussion of this, and that is I'd like to address something which the town attorney has already addressed when he was discussing this with the planning board, and that's whether or not your specific and very limited and restrictive provision for this kind of a facility will in any way adversely affect by a negative implication the right of an ordinary citizen to have his boat in his yard and to work on his boat and do so as is alike. And namely, that will the fact that this is now in effect make the ordinary citizen who wants to work on his boat have to comply with these very restrictive conditions, 5 acres and so forth. And I think the answer was given by Town Council Leahy to suggest that it would not in any way adversely affect the right of the citizen to take care of his own boat, be he lobster person or yacht person or whatever. That would be, assuming that the citizen lived in the house and that he owned the boat, that working on his boat, cleaning it up, building it, repairing it, and so forth, would be an activity ancillary to his occupation of the residence. And I think that's what Mr. Leahy suggested, and that we might keep that in mind. That the reason that we're here requiring a change for this particular use is that Mr. Sprague and his craftspeople don't only work on boats owned by Mr. Sprague, but they work on boats owned by other persons. And that's why it was felt that by the Board of Appeals that might not fit within the ancillary use. But the person working on his own boat, lobsterman or whatever, would fit within the ancillary use. And we suggest that your enacting of this provision would not adversely affect that person or make them comply with any new requirements. I won't take any more of your time unless there's some question about that issue. And instead, I know there are some members of the public who would like to address you on this particular subject matter. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Peter. Yes, sir.
Madam Chairman, I'm Colonel Reg Lombard. I live on Charles Jordan Road, and I am the closest abutter to Mr. Sprague. I would like to, first of all, commend his initiative in instituting this activity, and second of all, indicate that as his closest abutter, where any noise or activity or undesirable view would be the most noted, there is none, there has been none, I am sure there would be none, and I would commend your favorable consideration the ordinance as now proposed. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else wishes to speak? Yes, sir.
My name is Chris Bond, and I live on Ocean House Road in Cape Elizabeth. I am very familiar with the business that inspired this change in the ordinance, and I've read the changes that are proposed under this ordinance change, and I feel that they're very appropriate for this town. I think that the changes that we're talking about tonight are analogous to the farm stand in this community. We are a rural community. We need farm stands to support the farms we have here, and just in the same light as we are a maritime community, I feel that it's appropriate that this town offer these services to people who own boats in this town. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else wish to speak? Mr. Wolf.
Madam Madam Chairperson and members of the council, I am Dick Wolf. I live on Breakwater Farm, which is an abutting farm to the Sprague Farm. I have lived there for 31 years. I'm very appreciative of the rural nature of our area. I think that the ordinance and its amendment is so narrowly restrictive that it would in no way be in any concern to any neighbor, and I would wholeheartedly endorse your support of the change in the amendment so that Mr. Sprague can get on with his boat building. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
My name is Stu Rich. I live over the nursery down on the Ram Island Farm. I'm a neighbor and a friend of Finn Sprague's, and I'm here to support him on a issue that I feel pretty strongly about myself. I think the issue is larger than just Finn Sprague's boat building business or repair business. I feel personally very strongly about our maritime heritage. My family's been building and sailing wooden boats for a long, long time. I've kind of been a weak link in that heritage. I make my living growing trees, not shaping the wood that comes from them. And as such, I don't have the body of woodworking and shipwright skills to pass on to my son. I would like him to have the opportunity to acquire those skills and not have to go to Rockport or to Brooklyn to get them. I think I want my kids to grow up in a town where fishermen can build boats for themselves and other people in the wintertime, where farmers can grow crops and sell them at a retail center on their own land. I think there are probably very few opportunities that you have as counselors to protect this kind of heritage and to protect the kind of social fabric that is so important in this kind of community. I think this is one of those opportunities that you have. I hope that you make most of it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Is there anyone else from the public who wishes to comment? Yes, sir.
Madam Chairman, members of the council, I'm here on behalf of my wife because I'm really a resident by marriage and not by possession. And I...
Would you tell us your name?
Oh, excuse
please.
Me. I'm George Brett. Charles Jordan Road, most important part. You know, we all recognize the urban expansion and the suburban explosion and how to cope with this. And both of us think that this is a very great way of recognizing this and trying to come to grips with what is a very great problem in this day and age. And we heartily commend that this recommendation be carried through. Thank you.
Thank you, George. Anybody else? Last chance.
My name is Jack Van Zeeker, and I have the privilege and pleasure to live on Ram Island Farm. So in a way, I'm an abutter. The boat building business in Finney's barn, I see no objection to. And also, I'd just like to thank the board and all the committee members and all the public who have come to every meeting, sometimes till 12 o'clock at night, 1 o'clock at night. And most of the thrust has been to find a way to do this, and it seems like we've gotten closer and closer to that accomplishment. There's been very little opposition to the idea of building boats, but the mannerism and the mechanism in which we can do it and still satisfy and protect the rights of the other people in the community. And I feel we've come close, and you people have certainly come close to. And if you say yes, I guess we're that much closer. So I'd like to, again, hope that you vote in favor of this change. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Anybody else? If not, then we will close the public hearing and go to item number 102. To consider public hearing comments on proposed amendments to the zoning ordinance regarding boat repair facilities and take any necessary action. Councilor Lutori.
Madam Chairman, I move that it be ordered to amend section 19-2-2 of the Cape Elizabeth zoning ordinance by adding the words as we have in front of us that you had read earlier in the meeting.
Second.
Any discussion? Ready for the vote? Oh, Councilor Amaro?
I guess I just would like to thank everybody who has come to so many meetings and been so patient that the process does take a long time. But I think it takes a long time for good reason, because I think the compromise that we have before us tonight is an excellent one, and that I hope it will address the needs that were brought to us by Mr. Sprague, and that will also address the needs of the residents of the community as well.
All those in favor? Opposed? That's 5 yeas and 2 abstentions. Item number 103. We'll wait until you people clear up. We're going to hear the budget now, you know.
Oh, well. Look at that.
I know.
No, Doug wants everyone to sign them.
Wow. Who's this?
Doug. That's one of the joke gifts last night. Ready?
Open a public hearing on the fiscal year 1989 municipal school budget. Frank, would you like to introduce this?
Yes. Thank you, Madam Chairman. After numerous budget deliberations that we've had with the school committee and with the department heads of town, we have a budget finally prepared for a public hearing this evening and then vote by the Cape Elizabeth Town Council. I have some introductory remarks regarding the budget, some explanations, and a little bit of how we got here. This budget represents gross expenditures of $11.6 million, gross resources of $4.2 million, leaving money raised by taxation at $7,349,505. It represents a tax increase of 6.9%, with the taxes rising from $12.70 per thousand to $13.58 per thousand, or 88 cents. The original proposed increase proposed by the school board and the town manager was $1.05, or 8.3%, but after our thorough deliberations and numerous deliberations, it was reduced to 88 cents, or the 6.9%. There's three basic areas that I just will briefly outline in terms of where did the increases come from. The number one area, the area of increase was an area where we could do nothing about it. Increases where other people had set certain rates that we just have to pay the bill. The bill's sent to us and we have to pay it and we don't really have input. And unfortunately, that's a very sizable section. That includes the workers' compensation rate, refuse disposal, tipping fees, county taxes, water district, health benefits, et cetera. So the first area of increase is just something that we simply have our hands tied in, were rates that were passed on to us and we have to pay them. The second area is fairly rewarding those who are in our employ in the town. Those are the salary issues, and salary makes up 66% of this budget, which is in front of us this evening, salaries and the fringe benefits. So as you can see, it's very sizable. And third were the much-needed capital expenditures and repairs. And believe me, if any of you happen to see any or be at any of the meetings, we very, very scrupulously went over this budget, but there simply are things that need to be repaired in town or new items that we need because the old ones are falling apart. So we just addressed them this year. We went ahead and tackled it, and those that we felt were the absolute most needed are before us this evening. So the question at hand becomes, what does this $13.58 per thousand actually get the citizens? I believe this budget provides a continuation of quality services on both the town and the school side while adding some needed services and upgrading other areas that needed it. So within this budget, we have the creation of the first full-time town planner for Cape Elizabeth. We all know how important issues of growth and development are to us, and we feel that having a full-time town planner on the payroll is going to tremendously help us with the issue that's come up time and again as number one in people's minds in Cape Elizabeth. We also have the first full-time curriculum planner within this budget for the school department people to help better organize and draft their curricular needs. Other things within this budget are the replacement of certain roofs that were really needed over at the school, as well as other key replacements, road and sidewalk repairs in certain areas of the town, as well as battery repair at Fort Williams, a new trailer for hauling things from the transfer station, and another more efficient mower such that we can cut the grass with better utilization of labor. These are just some of the key larger ticket items, so to speak, but to show you that not only are we continuing quality services, but I feel proud of this budget because it adds in areas that were needed and appropriate. So in closing, I think the budget came under intense scrutiny, and as such, I feel it's a very cost-effective financial plan for fiscal year 89 for the town council. And I also want to thank my fellow councilors. It was a real experience heading up this committee. I thank you all. Sometimes we fought like cats and dogs, but we were always able to come out of it smiling and with friends. Certainly. And also I want to thank the school board for their input and their tremendous cooperation as well. We had very good meetings with them. Our town manager, Mike McGovern, and Superintendent Dr. Pelletier, as well as the department heads. It was a real cooperative effort, and I'm very proud to have this budget. I also wanted to mention the modular classrooms that we'll be discussing later in the evening, which are also part of this budget, to address the space crunch here in Cape Elizabeth. So.
Thank you, Frank. Well done.
Thank you.
We incidentally will be hearing three budgets tonight. This is the municipal school budget. We will be hearing next the sewer fund budget, and finally the Riverside Cemetery budget. So if anyone from the public wishes to address the biggest budget, that is the municipal school budget, the podium is yours. Mr. Adams.
I don't have to repeat my name. I am chairman of the Fort Williams Advisory Commission, and I'm here this evening to support the allocation that you people have so graciously made. But I could not leave this occasion alone because one of my favorite counselors is leaving for the last time, and I want Penny Carson to know that I am always a gentleman and I shall always be a gentleman with respect to the Goddard Mansion.
I intend to monitor all the meetings now.
But I'd like to leave you with a quote for you, your famous quotation that was on television with respect to the Stora House, if I may. You said very eloquently standing before that wreck in Waynefleet School that that this is not a building, this is a ruin.
Thank you very much, Henry. I'll see you after the meeting to give my explanation.
Is there anyone else who wishes to speak on the budget? It's a lot of money. Well, I guess our halos must be on straight. If there is no further comment, we will close the public hearing on the municipal school budget and consider item number 103, public hearing comments on the adoption of the fiscal year 1989 municipal school budget and take any necessary action. Councilor LaTorre.
Madam Chairman, the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, having held a public hearing veritably seconds ago, on June 13, 1988, upon the proposed fiscal year 1989 municipal budget, does hereby finally adopt a municipal budget for the town of Cape Elizabeth for fiscal year 1989 with gross expenditures of $11,624,721 and gross resources of $4,275,216. The amount of $7,349,505 to be raised by taxation, and does further fix October 4th, 1988 and May 6th, 1989 as the dates upon each of which one half of such taxes due and payable, with interest to accrue upon taxes due and unpaid after each such date at the rate of 11% per annum. That is my motion.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor of the budget? Opposed? It's unanimous.
Madam Chairman, I just like to, in the essence of levity here this evening, that the best part of sitting up here passing the budget is watching State Representative Webster's face. As the numbers have been read off to her, she's flushing, shaking her head. For the public, that's just the difference between 3 years, Mary, or... Yes.
Yes. We now come to the public hearing on the sewer budget. Frank.
Madam Chairman, the fiscal year 1989 sewer fund budget has gross expenditures of $1,150,285 and gross revenues of $1,103,740 as opposed to $1,001,000,000, which was reported in the local press. I just didn't wish to alarm anyone. I got a few calls on the billion, and we're not sewering the entire coast of Maine.
And I will now open the public hearing on the sewer fund budget. Is there anyone who wishes to comment? There being no comment, I will close the public hearing. And do we have a motion? Councilor Carson.
Cape Elizabeth Town Council, having held a public hearing on June 13, 1988, does hereby approve the fiscal year 1989 sewer fund budget with gross expenditures of $1,150,285,000 and gross revenues of $1,103,740,000. I move acceptance.
Second.
Is there any discussion? Councilor Jordan.
I didn't like that figure she gave. I think that's $1,150,285, not $285,000.
Probably is true. You can make it anything you want right now. But that's correct.
As
that stands corrected.
Any further discussion, corrections? All those in favor? Opposed? It's unanimous again. Next is the public hearing on fiscal year 1989 Riverside Cemetery budget. Frank?
Madam Chairman, the fiscal year 1989 Riverside Cemetery Trust Fund budget has gross expenditures of $12,130, gross revenues of $29,870, and we recommend adoption.
Second. Oh,
We have to have a public hearing. I will open the public hearing on the Riverside Cemetery. There being no comment, I will close the public hearing, and a motion is now in order.
Madam Chairman, the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, having held a public hearing on June 13, 1988, does hereby approve the fiscal year 1989 Riverside Cemetery Trust Fund budget with gross expenditures of $12,130 and gross revenues of $29,870.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? Unanimous again. Item number 106. To consider authorizing the expenditure of funds to purchase modular classrooms and take any necessary action. Michael.
Working with the school department, we have obtained proposals to construct what is the equivalent of four modular classrooms between the Lunt Building and the Pond Cove Elementary Building. It'll actually be used as sort of two classroom-type spaces, and the other classroom-type spaces will consist of the school media center. Through the excellent efforts of the school business manager, it was decided to go the route of actually constructing them on-site, stick-built, rather than bringing them in as modular. Modular probably is a poor terminology in the agenda. Because of that change, there's been a savings of approximately $25,000 over what would be brought in for modular classrooms. The school department did obtain bids working with the town, received a low bid from D&C Associates, a gentleman by the name of Dan Chipman, a general contracting firm here in Cape Elizabeth. The low bid was $89,825. In addition, would recommend a contingency of $5,125 for a total appropriation from undesignated surplus of $95,000. The school department will be receiving reimbursement through the school educational funding formula for these classrooms. They will actually be leasing them from the community on a five-year lease, and there will be a lease agreement before the council at a subsequent meeting. Thank you.
Is there any discussion? Councilor Carson.
Point of information that the finance chair just reminded me that that's a nickel saving on the tax dollar. Is that right? For the public?
Right. Councilor Tinsman.
Just one question from a lame duck. Finance committee member, where's the extra $50 going? Because that only adds up to $4,950. So it's government, I suppose.
Typo.
Dedication ceremony? I don't know.
You want to change that to 75?
Whatever.
Are we ready for a vote? We need a motion.
Oh, you need a motion.
I'll move it. I'll read it.
What do you want?
Oh,
go ahead.
I move that we appropriate $95,000 from undesignated surplus for the construction of modular classrooms and to authorize the town manager to sign a contract with DC Associations for $89,825 for the construction and to authorize the town manager to establish a $5,125 account for classroom project contingency and to request the town attorney to review a lease agreement between the town and the school department for presentation to the town council at its regular July meeting.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? It's unanimous. Item number 107. To consider the adoption of the pay classification plan for fiscal year 1989 and take any necessary action. Frank?
Madam Chairman, we discussed through the budget process basically a way of having a structured pay classification plan so that employees know where they're going at a set time over certain periods of time. This is rather in sync or more or less of an offshoot out of the budget process, but as it's written in our articles, we must formally adopt this pay classification plan, so I would recommend its adoption this evening.
Is that a motion?
So moved. I would move that it be ordered that pursuant to Article 2, Section 4 of the Town Charter, the Town Council does hereby approve 1989 pay classification plan and request the plan to be attached as an addendum to the minutes of this meeting.
Second.
Discussion. All those in favor of the motion? Opposed? It's unanimous. Item number 108. To consider setting the town manager's salary for fiscal year 1989 and take any necessary action. Frank, again.
Yes, I would move that it be ordered. This again was discussed in depth at the budget hearings. I would move that it be ordered that pursuant to Article 2, Section 4 of the Town Charter, the Town Council does hereby set the salary of the town manager for fiscal year 1989 at $46,000 per annum with all benefits currently in effect to continue in force.
Second.
Did someone have a question? Any discussion? Councillor Lester Jordan.
5% is all I have to say.
Any further comment? All those in favor of the motion, as read. It's unanimous.
Madam Chairman, just as for recollection, is this on every year? I don't ever remember voting for the town manager's salary specifically.
Yeah, it's supposed to be on every year. It was supposed to be on that the town council fixed every salary in the community. And the town charter was amended so that the old provision stayed in there that you still set the manager's salary by order of the council and that the pay classification plan takes the place of you setting all the other salaries. But it was always in the charter, it was just never followed.
It's just an interesting procedure to pass the budget and then pass these right after the budget. You know, it's in other words, if there was ever some year where there was a lot of discussion or debate and we'd already passed the funding for it, it's an oddity that I wonder why it's in our charter. Did it come up with the Charter Review Commission at all?
It was missed, wasn't it, maybe?
It just was never discussed by them.
Thank you for that historical backdrop.
You're welcome.
Item number 109, to consider a report from the Planning Board regarding a request by FS Plumber Company to rezone land on Eastville Road from RP to RA and take any necessary action. Michael?
Yeah, Mark Plummer, the president of FS Plumber Company, called late this morning and requested that this item be tabled as he had another commitment this evening.
Will it be tabled?
Second.
All those in favor? It's unanimous. Item number 110, to consider a report from the Planning Board regarding a recommendation to set a time limit on zoning variances and take any necessary action. Michael?
This recommendation has come forward from, I believe, originally the Board of Zoning Appeals and subsequently by the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board. Following a public hearing by the Planning Board. And basically what it does is once the Zoning Board approves a variance, this proposal sets a time limit on how long that variance is good for. And your customary procedure would be to refer it to the Ordinance Committee.
Do we have a motion?
Madam Chairman, I move that item 110 be sent to the audience.
Any discussion? Councillor Lester Jordan.
Reading it, I'm just wondering if when the Ordinance Committee reviews this, I'm just wondering what's going to happen if someone doesn't complete their building within a year. They're going to make them tear it down? What?
The Ordinance Committee's going to have to decide.
I think there should be some more work done on this, certainly, so I'm glad you're sending the Ordinance Committee.
I would think that the intention would be that the construction must begin a year from the granting. If the building is half done, no. I don't think anybody would ask them to tear it down, but if it hasn't started at all, then they'd have to get another permit or variance. Whatever. Isn't that the way it would work?
Well, it says here, I'm just hoping that it will review this part. It says here, substantially completed, with 1 year. They must, so it sounds to me like they have to have it just about completed. And I'm just wondering what happens if they don't. Do they?
I agree. I think it's extreme. At any rate, it will, the ordinance committee will toss this around. So do we have a motion?
Yes.
And a second. All those in favor? Opposed? Unanimous. Item number 111. To consider a report from the Board of Sewer Appeals regarding a request for a sewer extension from Theodore Wainwright and take any necessary action. Michael?
Thank you, Madam Chairman. The Board of Sewer Appeals met on two separate occasions on a request of Theodore Wainwright, the owner of most of the lots in the Riverview subdivision. Mr. Wainwright's request to the Board of Sewer Appeals in its advisory capacity, not in its appeals capacity, was to allow the hookup of lots 2 and 3, 10, 11, and 12, as shown on the Riverview subdivision plan, allow it to be connected to the municipal sewer. After much thought, consideration, and presentations by Mr. Wainwright as well as his attorney, the committee decided to recommend to the town council that an extension be granted of the municipal sewer for a distance of approximately 780 feet, extending from a current manhole at the end of Starboard Drive back towards Wells Road. The Board of Sewer Appeals, I think, looked at the issue with some concern as to precedent and as to the capacity of the treatment plant. They felt that this was a particularly a unique situation, primarily in two respects. The first was that when Mr. Wainwright first applied for a sewer connection, it was several years ago, and at that time a temporary moratorium was in effect prohibiting connections to the Spurwing treatment plant. So for that reason, they felt that Mr. Wainwright sort of fell between the cracks between the old policy and the new policy. Secondly, that they were quite concerned about the Spurwink Marsh and the environmental quality of it, and were concerned of septic discharges, septic systems being so in such close proximity to the marsh. So for that reason, they have recommended, after considerable discussion and review, that you approve the request of Theodore Wainwright for sewer extension. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael.
Madam Chairman,
Counselor.
Due to a conflict, I wish to abstain from this article.
Is there a consensus of the council that that's okay? All right. Any further discussion on this? Counselor Amaral.
Yeah, I'd like to ask the manager a question on the moratorium issue. The Wainwright property would not have received this number of sewer extensions even if there had not been a moratorium. Isn't that right? It would not have qualified to fill in the road.
Yeah, if the moratorium had not been in effect when they first applied, they would have been able to connect the entire subdivision to the sewer. It was before the current fill-in growth ordinance provisions took place is when it was first applied for.
I see. Okay. Thank you.
Do we have a motion?
I had one last comment. When I drafted this motion for the council, I put in here a provision that Mr. Wainwright would be required to pay for the review cost of the town attorney when looking at the plans. When doing that, I had forgotten that he would have to pay $3,000 in sewer connection fees. So I don't, you know, whoever makes the motion, I just wanted to point out I don't feel that strongly about that recommendation in that there will be a $3,000 contribution.
So
want to strike, we could just strike those words if we agree to?
I'd just leave it up to the council. I just wanted to raise the issue.
I'll move it. The council adopt the recommendation of the Board of Sewer Appeals and to approve the request of Theodore Wainwright for a sewer extension extending from the sewer manhole on Spurwink Avenue near the intersection of Starboard Drive, northeasterly for a distance of 780 plus feet, in order to enable the connection of residences on lots number 2, 3, 10, 11, and 12, as shown on the approved plan of the Riverview subdivision. This approval is conditioned upon approval of construction plans by the town engineer. Upon the receipt of Theodore Wainwright of any permits required by the Maine Department of Transportation, and upon Mr. Wainwright bearing the full expense of the this is the part I'm going to strike.
Until the word extension.
Yeah. Expense.
Of the extension.
Of the extension. The town council further notes that the extension is being granted due to extraneous circumstances as outlined in the May 19, 1988 minutes of the Board of Sewer Appeals.
Second.
Are you ready for the vote? All those in favor? Opposed? That's six yay and one abstention. To consider item number 112, to consider referring to the new Board of Sewer Appeals a proposed amendment to the sewerage ordinance, which would prohibit sewer connections into wetland areas and take any necessary action. Michael?
This one's been kicked around quite a bit. At one point, it was before the council, and it kind of died because of concerns with appeals process. Recently, the Department of Environmental Protection has written a letter to the Portland Water District indicating they will not release the final grant payment for the sewer treatment plant unless the town of Cape Elizabeth adopts an ordinance which would essentially prohibit sewer connections into areas that are classified as wetlands under executive order. I think it's 10998, or whatever the number is.
Councilor Torrey.
Madam Chairman, I move that it be ordered to refer to the Board of Sewer Appeals a renewed request by the Maine Department of Environmental Protection for the town to adopt the ordinance prohibiting sewer connections in wetland areas.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Unanimous. Item number 113, to consider a request to conditionally approve the dedication of a conservation easement to the town, to the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust, and to approve a pedestrian easement to the town at the Spinnaker Heights subdivision and take any necessary action. Michael?
Dr. Peter Rand, the chairman of the Conservation Commission, called me about 8:15 this morning asking that this item be tabled. We had received a request from the attorney for the property owners stating that it was in order. The town attorney had reviewed and approved the draft of the conservation easement. It had also been submitted to the attorney for the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. Dr. Ann told me this morning that while they had had some discussions with the property owners, he did not feel that it was sufficiently finalized, that he would like the town council to take final action this evening. And Dr. Rand has requested that this be tabled. I would like to mention that one of the property owners is present tonight as well.
Is it okay if he speaks? The motion hasn't been made.
Just have a question. This dedication of a conservation easement, whatever, is this part of the planning board process, or is this part of the conservation commission process that we're trying to come to grips with here tonight? I mean, if we're asked to accept or grant certain easements as part of the planning board process, why is it the last minute effort of the conservation commission to insert themselves in the process? I'm not clear on this land trust conservation planning board review.
Michael?
The review at this point is before the planning board. This proposed subdivision is before the planning board at a meeting, I believe, on the 23rd. for final subdivision approval. It has always been customary before final approval that the town council first take action on dedications, whether or not to approve them or if there's any acceptance of town easements. The Conservation Commission's role has always been to advise the planning board and, in fact, to negotiate some of these easements. It was my distinct impression from minutes of earlier Conservation Commission meetings that there had been an agreement. Apparently, I misunderstood the Conservation Commission minutes, and Dr. Rand, as of this morning, did ask for it to be tabled.
Councilor Jordan.
if this dedication takes place, is 10% of this development going to the town of Cape Elizabeth?
No.
Under the basis of our new ordinance, 10% of the land.
It's either or.
Well, I know it's either or, but I don't agree with the or.
Well, it's got to be changed.
I think this, I'm not totally positive of this, but this is a minor subdivision and not a major subdivision. And I'm not sure that that kicks in a minor subdivision. I'd have to check that. But I think that provision is under the criteria for major subdivisions.
Michael, we're going to be, whole business is being referred to the Ordinance Committee, isn't it?
If you take that action later this
yeah.
evening. Yes, next time.
Councilor Torrey.
Madam Chairman, I guess I'm still a little not worried about the process, but the process doesn't seem to be all that smooth. If you have to pick up inferences based on minutes, which are sometimes written by secretaries that aren't, you know, exactly clear, or in other words, I don't believe that in any way, shape, or form should the town manager receive an official notification as important as this by having to read the minutes of another board's meeting. It should have been given, obviously, to the Conservation Commission that would then pass some type of a statement that would then be sent to the town manager. I really would like to see that tightened up, hopefully, so that there's no further misunderstandings or that you have to garner key bits of information from minutes. If that was the point of yeah. You know.
Yeah, it was, you know, the same situation on the Eastfield issue earlier. And from the Board of Sewer Appeals, you probably noticed the references were from the minutes. You know, they don't customarily send letters of transmittal. They send the minutes, and we pick those up. I was very surprised to hear this morning that it wasn't in order, in that, you know, as the town attorney's letter indicates, that all the attorneys for the land trust of the town and for the property owners had been fully involved in the discussion. And the minutes, I swear, I haven't checked them since this morning, but I thought they were very clear.
I would still like to see a way, other than through the minutes, that you get the information. There should definitely be some motion passed that you then get a copy of, really formalized, you know, language that's very, very clear, rather than a secretary's interpretation of what's happened.
Councilor Tinsman.
I just have some real problems in trying to cope with this telephone conversation this morning and trying to interfere with the planning board's process. If the developer who's in the audience agrees that a tabling would not affect his project, then I would certainly remove any reservations I have. But I'm concerned that the attorneys have been contacted, the language has been worked out, and then a last-minute phone call says, well, just put it off for a while. Well, that holds up the process. We're under a certain amount of time by ordinance to review these subdivisions, and I just wonder how this, you know, if it were to be tabled tonight, how this would affect the process.
Councilor Jordan.
Yeah, I'm still not clear. If this is if this development is small enough so it doesn't come under that new ordinance amendment that we made, gift of 10%, and the developer isn't interested in having a table, I don't understand what connection the Conservation Commission or anybody else has with the thing.
Could we ask
there
developer?
There is land dedication
like
going
to
the land trust.
Has so. Been This gentleman has been waving his arm from the back of the room. Yes, sir. Would you come up to the podium and identify yourself?
Gary Cummings, one of the owners of the property. I know my other partner, William Owens, he walked the land with three members of the Conservation Committee, including Mr. Rand, and was taking their input. We're basically getting suggestions from them. We're not involved in this a lot, so they suggested that we contact their attorney, it was a bank representative, I believe, for People Heritage, to get some ideas on making these deeds up and putting them to our attorney, so we did that. I met with the Conservation Committee on one of their nights and reviewed it, and I'm under the same understanding as Mr. McGovern, that it was accepted. We had worked with him fairly and taken any ideas and pretty much agreeing with whatever ideas they had. And I'd like to see you address it tonight just because the Planning Board expects a complete package, and I think that they'll use this as a way of saying there's an incomplete package and put us off another month or whatever. So I feel that my attorney's told me and my land representative, Mr. Mitchell, has told me that the town attorney's reviewed it and found it acceptable. And I'd like to see it go ahead tonight.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Michael.
I would like to clarify this in the section of the subdivision regulations. While it follows the section relating to approval of major subdivisions, it is under a separate section, so it would apply to both major and the minor subdivisions, the provisions for dedication. Yeah.
But is that 10%, where's that 10% going?
What is
the town? Town or
it's in the letter. It says in the letter. Okay.
Or a private entity somewhere.
The land trust.
There's two. There's two that are being dedicated. One is land, right? One is a conservation easement, and the other one's a pedestrian easement. Right.
Mm-hmm. Councilor Torrey.
Mr. Manager, could you once again restate what the gist of the phone call this morning was?
It seems
just to me that's the critical bit of information that I have to do.
It was very early this morning, late night last night. I just felt the strong sense that Dr. Ann would like to take a look at it again. But what he specifically said was that it was not his failing that they had come to a final agreement.
The
Conservation Commission has a committee meeting at the town hall, in a formal meeting. That was the impression that he left me.
So, see, this is kind of a problematic situation for me here, to say the least, because I have to then rely that the chairman has called you to say, we have not made a decision. And Michael felt through an interpretation of the minutes that they had made a decision. But to me, it's clear that if the chairman has called and said, we have not made a decision, I'm sorry you misunderstood the minutes, then we owe it to our Conservation Commission to come to a final decision. So that's why I stated earlier, I'm very worried about this process, if that is the gist or the crux of what we're talking about here.
Madam Chairman?
Yes.
Might I suggest that you table this until at the end of the meeting? And meanwhile, the town clerk could obtain the minutes of the Conservation Commission and perhaps also try to contact Dr. Rand so he could speak for himself.
That would be very helpful. That would be very helpful.
Before a motion like that is made, I'd like also for the chairman of the Planning Board to be contacted. In fact, perhaps before Chairman Rand, because the preliminary approval of this project has been held. I don't know if there was a public hearing, but certainly there was preliminary approval, final approval. And that stage has been approved. And I want to know what happened from that stage until now with the Conservation Commission. I'm really concerned now that the tail is wagging the dog here and our role is granting these easements.
Yes, sir.
When I met with Mr. Rand, Mr. Hollidge, Matt Clifford, and I believe Mr. Butler was there, and another person, I asked for a letter to express in their support and agreement with the plan for the Planning Board, just so we'd have that so they'd be satisfied with it.
And they said, yeah, we'll get you a copy of the minutes, and that'll take care of it. So they didn't want to offer a letter. They wanted to go by the minutes. And they thoroughly told me that that sounded fine and that they were all pleased with it. Okay, I'd just like to say that. And,
by the way, did you ever get a copy of the minutes?
I didn't.
You didn't get a copy of the minutes?
No. Maybe John Mitchell did, but I did not.
Okay.
I
just wanted to see if you had read it to see what your interpretation of the minutes
were. I thought, until tonight, and I was sitting back there and I read this poster right here saying that, I was kind of shocked because I thought everything was worked out. I mean, we sat down and worked out these. They gave us the input, and that was it.
Yeah.
So it's not as if that we were making decisions. We were basically taking their input and working with them on it.
Understood.
Councilor Jordan?
They'll only take one phone call. I have a problem with the easement, and just the way it's worded, or either, maybe I don't quite understand it. In timber cutting and vegetation, and the destruction and the removal of standing timber. Anybody that understands forestry and understand trees and what have you a little bit, it is smart sometimes to go in there and take out a tree when it's is made its full growth and not let it stay there and die and rot away. And I don't quite get that in this easement that it's allowed. And I was somebody, there's possibility of clear cutting, which I'm not 100% in favor, but I think when a tree has made its growth, it's just like growing a strawberry or a cabbage when it's ripe, it's time to pick it. And that's the same way with a tree. And I have trouble with the easement myself, but I'll make a motion that we table it till the end of the meeting so maybe we can get these things cleared up, because I'm disturbed at the process myself, 100% disturbed.
Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Unanimous. We'll take a short recess while the clerk is looking for her minutes and the manager is making two phone calls.
One.
One? Talking to two individuals. We will be back shortly.